When it comes to character animations, what do you think is the most important animation or action you should know how to animate? I'll give you a hint. It's something we all do every single day, hopefully. If your answer was talking, then you'd be wrong. The most important animation you can master is the walk cycle. Why? Well, I'll tell you. Every lesson you need to learn in order to animate your characters well can be learned through mastering the walk cycle. Walk cycles are the foundation of character movement. In this lesson, I'll attempt to simplify the walk cycle into individual, easily digestible components, as well as share my process for quickly creating a base walk cycle that can then be modified and built upon to tell a story. So let's not waste any more time and dive right in. Are you kidding me? Another walk cycle tutorial? Well, this week's video is actually a lesson from my course on character animation called Character Animation Launchpad. To learn more about the course, stick around to the end of the video, but for now, enjoy this free lesson. All right, Norm, roll it. Since we are creating a looped animation, all I have to do is animate two steps. We can break the animation of the walk cycle into three major components: the body, which includes the head and neck, the legs, and the arms. I like to start with the body because everything on our character is either directly or indirectly parented back to the body, which means that the motion of the body affects the motion of everything else. So it makes sense to start there. Once I'm done with the body, I like to move on to the legs next and then finish with the arms. I like to nail down the animation of the legs before the arms because once the animation of our legs is established, that will help us determine the animation of the arms, which always swing in the opposite direction of the corresponding leg. Okay, so with that little roadmap laid out, let's get started on how to animate the body. So, like I said, to create a loop, I just need to create two steps, and that means I need my body to bob up and down just twice. To create this, I'll divide my work area, which is set to 16 frames long, in half and create a keyframe on the middle frame. Then I'll copy that keyframe and paste it to the first and last frame of the work area. Now, there are two things we need to remember when creating a looped animation correctly. First, always remember to place your last keyframe so that they line up with the end bracket. Second, make sure that the first and last keyframes are the same. So anytime you make an adjustment to either of these keyframes, remember to copy and paste them to maintain the loop. So these three keyframes that we just created are going to be the low point of our body's up and down motion. This is what is called the contact pose, which is when both feet are contacting the ground at the same time. We want the position of the body to be just low enough that there'll be some bending of the knee. If you need to adjust this, select all the keyframes, and with your playhead on one of the keyframes, you can adjust all three keyframes at the same time to bring your character's body down. I'll bring all three keyframes down just until the knee is bent a little bit. Note that you don't have to commit to this. We can always come back later and adjust this. Next, we'll create a high position in between these keyframes. Select both of these new keyframes and then move your body up until the legs are more or less straight. For now, I'll select all these keyframes and hit F9 to apply a default easy ease to our keyframes. And then on these two keyframes where our body is at the highest point, I'll adjust the easing influence by opening the keyframe velocity. Default easing influence is around 33%, but we want to increase the easing on these keyframes to about 80%. This will serve to accentuate the body's bounciness. How much you increase this really depends on your own individual taste. I'll take this moment to do a quick RAM preview to assess how the animation is looking so far. And I think it's looking pretty good. Now we're going to emphasize the bounciness of the character by adding in some rotation keyframes to this animation. Create a keyframe on the rotation to correspond with each position keyframe. Then on the contact keyframes, remember that's these three keyframes, rotate the body forward a little bit. Then select the keyframes and bump them forward one frame or two frames if you're animating on ones or 24 frames per second. Then alt-click on the rotation stopwatch and add a loop in expression. Select the rotation and copy it. This will copy the keyframes and that loop in expression we just added, and we're gonna paste those on the rotation of the neck layer and then offset that by one frame, and then we're going to do the same for the head. And with that, I am pretty much done with this stage of the animation and can move on to the legs. Hey, I just wanted to pop in and pause the video for a quick reminder to hit that like button and help me defeat my arch nemesis, the YouTube algorithm. The more likes I get, the stronger I become as I battle it out to beat the algorithm and reach more people. If you hit that like button, I'll appreciate you, and let's get back to the lesson. To recap what we just did, we created two up and down motions for each step. We adjusted the easing to enhance the bounciness, and then we added some rotation to the body so that it would lean forward on the down position. And then we copied those rotation keyframes and pasted them to the neck and head, while also offsetting each layer to add some overlapping action. To animate the legs, I'll start with the right ankle by bringing up the position on that layer by hitting P on my keyboard. On the first frame, I'm going to bring the foot back, then I'll copy that keyframe and paste it on the last frame of my loop. Then in the middle, I'll bring my ankle forward just out in front of the body, so now we have the back and forth motion. Next, I'll right click on the position and click separate dimensions so that we have keyframable properties for X and Y positions. On the first half where the foot is moving forward, I'll add a keyframe on the Y position to bring the foot up as it comes forward. Now I'm going to hold shift and hit R so that I can add the rotation property to my soloed properties here. And I'll create a keyframe on the rotation to correspond with each keyframe on the Y position. Then when the foot lifts, I'll adjust the rotation so that the foot is pointed downward. Then right before the foot is planted on the ground, I'll add another rotation keyframe and point the foot slightly up. And then I'm going to budge this middle keyframe over one. Having these rotation keyframes on either side of the middle keyframes makes it appear that the heel hits the ground first as our character takes a step. It's the small little details that matter. Next, we'll add a loop in expression to all three properties. Then I'm going to select the keyframes and copy them. Then on the left ankle, I'll bring my playhead to the middle frame and paste those keyframes. From here, we may need to make some adjustments to the X property until the length of the stride looks about right. Now, here's a tip to improve your animations. If you go into your ankle controller setting and open up dynamics section, there is a property called anti-pop. Crank this puppy up and see what happens. That anti-pop just adds a little bit of a buffer to the length of your limb so that the leg doesn't bend so abruptly as your character plants their foot. This is a common problem in animating in After Effects, and we can get around it with this anti-pop feature that is included with Limber. Now, the legs are pretty much done, but before we move on to the arms, there is one little adjustment we need to go back and make to the body. Let's go back to the body and add a loop in expression to the position. Then select all the keyframes on the body, neck, and head, and let's nudge them down one frame. Why did we do this? Well, as Richard Williams puts in the Animator's Survival Kit, walking is a process of falling over and catching yourself just in time. So that means that the lowest part of our body's motion, of that up and down motion, should happen on the frame after the foot makes contact with the ground to catch our character from falling. This delay in the body's motion is called overlapping action. I purposely waited until we were done animating the legs in order to illustrate the relationship that the body's motion has to the legs. Now, to recap what we just did with the legs, first we animated the back and forth motion, then we added the up and down motion, then we added the rotation of the foot in, then we added a loop in expression to the position and rotation properties so that we can copy those keyframes and paste them in the middle of the composition on the left ankle, thus offsetting the steps of each ankle from each other. Then we tightened up the animation by cranking up the anti-pop setting on both legs. Then to finish up the section, we went back to offset the body keyframes by one frame so that we can get a more realistic motion. Okay, so now we are ready to move on to the arms. We'll be animating the arms differently than how we animated the legs. instead of keyframing the position of the wrist controller to move back and forth, we are going to be using what is called FK, which means I'll create the movement of the arms by keyframing the rotation of each joint manually. To switch to FK, I just need to have this setting cranked all the way up to 100. Now, whenever animating with FK, I do need to make sure that I've created an FK controller with the Add FK button. And then I need to pick whip my hand layer to that controller instead of the original wrist controller. You might be wondering why I want to manually keyframe the rotation of the joints instead of just keyframing the position of the wrist to swing back and forth. The simple answer is that swinging motions, like the arms swinging back and forth as our character walks, turn out better when we use FK instead of the traditional IK. The main reason is that FK just naturally creates this arcing motion. I'll create keyframes for the upper and lower rotation, then on the rotation of the FK controller layer. Using these three rotation properties, I'll swing my arm forward because the right leg starts backward. And remember, I mentioned that the arm's motion is always supposed to be going in the opposite direction of the corresponding leg. Now, just like always, I'll copy these first set of keyframes and paste them to the end, and then I'll go to the middle and I'll move my arm backward so that it's going back now. Then I'll add a loop in expression to all the keyframe properties, noting that on the FK wrist controller, we'll have to add the loop in expression all the way at the bottom. We do not want to mess with any of this stuff. Next, I'll offset each row of keyframes by one frame, starting with the upper rotation. So I'll offset the lower FK by one frame from the upper FK, and I'll offset the wrist by one frame from the lower FK keyframes. Now that we are done with the right arm, just like with the legs, we'll save some time by copying the keyframes and pasting them on the left wrist at the halfway point. However, for the wrist controllers, we don't want to copy these keyframes over because we'll inadvertently copy the expressions as well, and we don't want to do that. So in this case, we'll have to manually keyframe the rotation and add in that loop expression on the left FK wrist controller. Now there's one last adjustment that we need to make before we're done with this walk cycle. The point at which our arms are furthest apart should line up with the down position of our body. So just like with the body, we'll offset the arm rotation keyframes one frame so that the upper rotation keyframes line up with our body at its lowest point. So for the final recap, we switched the arms to FK and created an FK wrist controller that we pick whipped our hand layer to. Then we keyframed the rotation of the shoulder, elbow, and wrist to swing back and forth. Then offset the keyframes for each joint by one frame from the joint above, starting with the shoulder. Then we copied that animation to the other arm and offset the animation of both arms by one frame to line up with the motion of the body. So that's it. That is how you create a base walk cycle. Now that we understand how the different parts of a walk cycle work together and fit together, we can explore some ways of tweaking those different components to give the walk cycle character and to tell a story, which we continue to explore in the course. What we just created is just a simple template that can be built upon to create more unique and interesting animations. Also, allow me to insert a disclaimer here that this is just the beginning. There are more aspects to a walk cycle that we just can't cover in one video. My goal with this lesson is just to provide a workable starting point to nail down the basics. If you enjoyed this lesson, go check out Character Animation Launchpad, where I elaborate on walk cycles even more, and I cover everything from character design to rigging to animation, as well as some more advanced techniques like foreshortening and 2.5D character animations. In the course, I teach you how to use Limber to its fullest potential. I teach things like how to create a head rig that can express emotions with Duik, and how to plan and execute more advanced character animations that involve perspectives, plus a bunch of other tricks and tips of the trade. If you're interested in learning more about the course, I've left a link in the description below. Well, that about does it for this week's video. Once again, if you enjoyed this video, help me gain the upper hand in the war against the YouTube algorithm by hitting that like button. If you want more content like this, make sure you are subscribed and you have that bell notification turned on so that you are notified the second a new video is up. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video. Bye now.